Pushed it the wrong way. That's my bad. That's on me. It's a good start. So, good morning, though. I'm glad to be here with you guys. I'm usually speaking to a lot younger crowd. Not saying that y'all are old, all right, but usually it consists of about 4-year-olds, 5-year-olds, and I'm going, hey, sit down. So if you get up and move around, it's okay, all right? I'm used to it. If you need to go to the restroom, that's fine too, all right? It's probably going to be shorter than normal because I'm not a very long-winded person, but I am pleased to be able to be asked to come up and talk about our outreach opportunities and what we have. Missions and outreach is something that's very important to my life. Growing up, my dad was a pastor, so my dad's been a pastor my whole life. Was able to see him do ministry and watch him do it really well and just love on people in the community. And then was able to go on a lot of mission trips as well throughout high school and in college and even after college at churches previous to here. So missions is a big part of my life. It's very important. It should be to all of us. And if it's not, then that's what I'm trying to do this morning, is to convince you that it's important every single day. It's important here, and it's important far as well. But just start off with a little story. How many of you guys like to do puzzles? You guys like puzzles? Anybody? Puzzles, right? So me and my wife, Julie, we like to do puzzles. I don't know if it's just that because it's quiet and we like feel like we're old or older and just come together and work on something. And we just love enjoying puzzles. We usually get a couple puzzles for Christmas or our birthdays, and we have a nice puzzle table that I bought from Ollie's that was awesome. So we got a nice puzzle table that we pull out. And there's many different types of puzzles, right? There's a lot of puzzles. The most basic puzzles are rectangular or square. But there's different shapes puzzles. There's big puzzles. There's puzzles with only 20 pieces for the younger kids. There's pieces that are up to 300, 500, 1,000. Usually we try and stick in the 500 range because 1,000 just takes too long and I get tired of it. And I'm like, all right, we got to do something different. But there's a lot of different puzzles out there, and they all have a different picture and show something beautiful in the end. We were working on this one puzzle recently, and we're getting close to the end. And you know that feeling when you get close to accomplishing something where you're like, yes, it's almost there. I get to see it. And we realize there's going to be one piece that's short, right? We see there's five spots left in the puzzle. There's only 4 pieces, and we're like, oh, great. This is not good, right? So we're looking around, right? We've already saved one piece from the dog. We go to the dog again, see if it's got a piece in its mouth, chewing on still. No, it's not in the dog's mouth. Finally, we're looking under the coffee table, and there it is. We find the piece in the basket of blankets that's under their coffee table, because who doesn't have a whole basket full of blankets under their coffee table? We do. But we find the piece, and we put it in that sigh of just relief of completion, and say, yes, it looks beautiful, right? It's done. It's awesome. Well, I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit this morning about just how God has designed his churches to be his puzzles, all right? So We'll go along this journey together. But God has designed his churches to be these beautiful pictures, right, that he has created. But we have to be willing to put them together and be the parts in order to make it work. So the first thing we're going to look at this morning, all right, is that the church is the puzzle, okay? If you guys want to go ahead and open up to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, that's where we'll be today. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, look at a few verses there. But the church is the puzzle, right? We as people, part of the church, as followers of Christ, should be all about God's mission, about his purpose, and coming together, right, to serve those and to reach people around us, right? It's the most fulfilling thing that we can do. When we serve others and serve them, all right, then we get this sense of satisfaction about ourselves. We actually just talked about this in a Wednesday night class. And we even joked around because it's a couples class. And we said, well, this week we're going to go and we want to keep track of who is serving their spouse more, right? Now, we're kind of making fun of it a little bit. But there's definitely, I mean, all of us are competitive a little bit. Me and my wife are both competitive, played sports in high school and college. And so we're competitive. So I sometimes bring it up, well, I just recently did 2 loads of laundry, washed the dishes, and took out the trash. So I'm up at least 4 to 1, whatever you have. But when we serve people, right, when we serve others, it gives us this sense of gratification, this sense of satisfaction that we are helping those around us. But God wants it not just to be with people that we love, people that we care about, but he wants us to be serving and reaching other people that are in our community that are less fortunate than us, that need to hear his word. So, another question I have for you guys. Have you ever tried to work on a puzzle and not looked at the box or the picture that they give you? You guys ever tried to do that? Right? It's really hard, okay? I started to do it one time, and you can maybe get the framework of it because you can find the edges and kind of figure it out possibly. But then after that, you're like, where does all this go, right? We have to be people that look at what God's puzzle is. We have to look at the instruction that he's given us. He's given us the instruction right here in his holy word that we can see what the puzzle is supposed to look like, all right? So we're going to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we'll start in verse 12. And it says, "For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, both Jews and Greeks, slaves and free, and all were made to drink of one spirit." See, all of us are a part of God's body. We're all a part of his church, right? It's not just the pastors that are part of the church. It's not just the pastors and the deacons that are part of his church. It's not just the people that come to church 95% of the year, because that would probably cross out most of us in here, including myself sometimes, depending on the year and how well the Braves are doing that season, right? But not the Jaguars, that's for sure. But we are all a part of the church, right? We're all a part of the body together as one. We continue to look on, all right? And the next thing I want you guys to see is, as the church is the puzzle, all right, you guys probably seeing where it's going, we are the pieces, all right? We are all the pieces to the puzzle that God has. So we look in verse 14, continue on. It says, "For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, 'Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body. For if the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he has chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body." So we look at this scripture, right, and we think about, he's using the illustration of a body. Now, let's go back to when we were kids, all right, when we were younger, and we used our imagination a lot, okay? We started to draw things on papers, and you guys remember, or maybe you guys that have young kids, right, you get pictures of the family, of you and your friends, and the pictures are big old heads and a small body and maybe an ear or so, but the bodies are all looking differently. Now, we think about if there was just a body full of arms, let's say, all right? Our arms are made to do a lot of great things, right? Pick things up, put them down, work out sometimes, not anymore, but we used to, right? Pick up our food, eat it, grab things with our hands, okay? But if our arms were used as legs the whole time, right? It would not work out very well, okay? Now, I know some people in here are very athletic, very good at gymnastics, things like that. They're like, "Oh, I can walk on my hands very easily." Well, I'm very proud of you, okay? But I cannot do that. But you can only do it for a certain amount of time, right? Before your arms get tired and you realize, hey, this probably isn't the way that I'm supposed to continue to move around this world, right? God gave me 2 legs to walk on. He gave me 2 arms to reach out with, all right? And so the idea that our body would be all one part is just ridiculous. We know that. But that's how we operate as a church a lot of times, right? A lot of people want to be an arm, and nobody wants to be a leg or part of the foot. They're like, "Oh, that looks so much better. Let me just go do that. Let me go be a greeter once every 2 months, and I can do that, and I'm a part of that arm, but let's not worry about this stuff that's over here, right? Or let's not reach out and go into the community and go reach someone out here because that may be a little hard. It might feel a little weird. It might take me out of my comfort zone. I'm fine with just staying right here and doing a little bit of this every once in a while. You see, God doesn't want us to be just all the same body parts. He's made us all unique and special with special gifts and talents. And there's people in this world that you can reach way better than I can reach them, right? You're like, well, you're a pastor. You're right, I am a pastor. A very young pastor who's learning a lot still and loves God and loves people and wants to reach every person for the gospel. But the matter of fact is that God has designed you to reach people better than he's designed me, because I cannot reach every single 8 billion people that we talked about in that song that God has designed and made and loved. We have to do it together. So no part of the body is better than the other. You're like, well, Pastor Jake, that's not true, right? The heart, a lot of these people in medical field, like, if you don't have a heart, then you're probably not going to live, right? You're not going to be able to go very far, okay? Well, let's just take that part out real quick, okay? Every part of the body, right, needs to be working together to make it work the way it's supposed to go, right? Every single part. Every part is important, right? Even your nose, even your hairs on your head. For some of us, don't have those anymore. That's okay, right? It's all right. But every part is important. And when everybody comes together and serves the community around them, that is when all the pieces come together and we can see the beautiful picture that God has for what his church is supposed to do, right? But the problem is we have so many people that are puzzled pieces. They don't know who they are. They don't know what they're supposed to be doing. They don't know how God's designed them. They don't know the passions that they have. Or maybe you know the passions that you have, but you just don't live out in those passions for what God wants you to do. So we have so many people who are puzzle pieces, and they don't know what they're supposed to be doing or where they're supposed to be doing it at. Now, it says in verse 18, right? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. Now, that's not the pastor chose what part of the body you are. It's not the pastor or even the deacon or the board of committee, right, chose what part of the body that you get to be for God. No, God has already chosen what you are supposed to be, but he's not going to come and say,
hello there, Jake. I've chosen you to be a finger today, all right? And you're going to be the best finger you can be, right?
We have to be people who seek after God and love him and seek after who he is so that we know our passions and the way that he created us and gave us these special gifts and abilities so that we can go and live out our full potential in what God has asked us to do. Scripture verse that we're going to look at, Micah 6:8. A lot of you guys know it, right? He has told you, this should be up on the screen, he has told you, oh man, what is good, oh, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. We're supposed to be people who walk in justice, who walk in mercy, who people can see our attitudes and our actions, and they see a difference. They see Christ in us. Now, the end result of all of these things that we're talking about, right, that we are living out of our passions and our gifts, is to bring people to the gospel, right? God made me to love sports and to be active and to do things, and I was able to play ball in high school and in college. But if I just played ball to have fun and to try and be the best athlete on the field or to try and win the top awards or even for, as a team concept, to win a championship, if that's all I cared about in playing ball, then I missed the point of why God made me to love sports and to playing ball, right? At a very young age, I was able to understand. My dad put it into my head, son, the reason that you're good at sports is because you're going to be able to build relationships with kids on that team that no one else can. These are kids that don't have a dad, kids that don't have other friends, or kids that think that they're just better than others, and you need to be an example to them of Christ in every sense of the way. So throughout high school, I was able to play sports and was able to build relationships with kids. Was taught, hey, if you're just playing this to play, then you're going to get out, right? It needs to have a purpose behind it, right? You need to play to your best of your ability in everything you do, but you also need to be telling people about Christ. I said, well, Dad, I invited them to come to church. Well, son, that's not what I told you to do, right? That's not what God tells you to do. He didn't say invite them to church. Now, that's great. Hopefully they come, but I'm telling you that your life, the way you live, the lifestyle that you've chosen, your actions, your words, and the things that you say to them directly should be all about the gospel and glorifying God. Now, I'd love to sit up here and say, and I had all 25 of my baseball teammates come to the Lord. That didn't happen, right? But there's probably a few of them that saw a change and started to come to church and realized, you know what, there's something different about this kid. See, God gives us these passions, these gifts to use for his glory. If we just sit there and take in all the glory and take in all the fun that we have in it, then we're misusing the things that God has given us. But serving is for everyone, all right? It's not just for people who are really outgoing. It's not just for people who are really good at controlling kids because it's super hard to do. I know, I did it for a while. All right, some of you are like, yeah, you did a good job. Some of you are like, yeah, you didn't do a good job. My kid's still crazy. Well, that's on you. You're the parent, okay? I was just a children's pastor at the time, all right? So I only have a couple hours with them. You have a lot more. But that's for all the children's pastors out there. But everyone is called to serve in some way. Not just serving. It's important to serve in the church and in the children's ministry and student ministry and greeting and things like that. But we're also talking about serving in the community as well, all right? And so we have things that we are giving you all as our ministries, our outreach opportunities that you can be involved in, right? So this is the parts of the puzzle that God's already put for University Church, right? So this is what our puzzle would look like. Here's the different opportunities at University Church that we have. We should have a list of them up there on the screen as well, but the corner food pantry, right? This is an outreach opportunity that happens every single Tuesday, okay? Every single Tuesday, we open up those doors and people come that need food and are hungry and we give them food and we give them something to eat and people sit there and they talk with them and they build relationships with them and they just love on those people. We say, well, I can't come Tuesday during the day, Pastor Jake, to serve and to give out food. Well, that's great. That's okay. That's fine. You can give food to the pantry anytime you want, right? You can bring it Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, probably even Saturday. Someone's going to be up here doing something. So you can bring food and give to the food pantry to give to those that are in need. Another one that we have is the Mount Carmel bus ministry, right? We have people that go and pick up people that live down in Mount Carmel that don't have rides, that aren't able to physically get here themselves, and we have them go drive down, pick them up Sunday morning, take them back Sunday night or Sunday evening, and then they pick them up Wednesday night and take them back Wednesday night after church as well. Just a simple way to pick up and to share and build relationships with people who just physically cannot get to our facilities, right? And they're learning about Christ. Another one we have, Hadassah's Hope, right? These are ladies that go into clubs and they build relationships and minister to ladies that feel like they have no hope or feel like they're not loved, and they tell them, you are not only loved by me, but you are loved by God, the Creator, who has a perfect and awesome plan for you. And they give them this light that they don't have to continue to do this sort of work. They don't have to continue to live this lifestyle, and that they can have something greater than that. Other ministries that we have, Launchpad, Stable Palms Ministry, right? Pastor Trey and I were able to start doing this a couple years ago whenever I first came on. And now Pastor Trey and his wife Stanton are leading it. But Stable Palms is an after-school program that's at Stable Palms Apartments down off of Emerson Street. And they go there from 3 to 5 every single day that Duval County has school, and they tutor those children and work that they need, because a lot of those families are refugees and people that come from all over the world, so their parents don't know any of the school that they're learning. But they tutor them, they give them some food to eat, and they hang out with them and love them, and they teach them about God's word, which is huge because a lot of these people are from Muslim families or they're from around the world where they have not heard at all. And so they're building relationships with these kids, and they're teaching them about Jesus. And we've seen many kids come to faith just in that program alone. They also have a bus that goes and picks them up on Wednesday nights and brings the youth out to our Wednesday night service here. Some other opportunities, Vida Abundante, which is our Spanish-speaking service that happens right here in this building after we meet here, right? It's a way for us to reach the community that's around us. God has placed so many Spanish-speaking people around us, and we said, well, we need to offer them something, and Pastor Frank has shared his heart about that to a lot of you, as you know, and Pastor Henry Cruz is leading that, but they need help. It's not just, oh, well, I don't speak Spanish, I can't help out. No, that's not the case, right? We're going to have times where, coming up, we're going to go out into the community and we're going to flood the community with a ton of information about, hey, we have a service for you, we have a place for you, we have a story that you want to hear and how God loves you, and inviting people to come. And you can help out with, if you're talented in worship, then you can help play up here. You don't have to know how to sing in Spanish to know some of the songs that you're playing and worship God in the same, in a different language as you're praising out to for the congregation. It's amazing experience. I've been a part of many different services in different parts of the country where the Holy Spirit has moved me incredibly when I have no idea what these little kids or these people are singing, but I just know that they're singing and praising God to the fullest. It's an incredible experience. Some other things coming up, VBS for us, Vacation Bible School, right? We're going to put on Vacation Bible School. That's going to be at the end of July. And we'll have more details coming out really soon about that. But this isn't just for our kids to grow deeper in their faith, although they should. But this Vacation Bible School is a huge outreach opportunity for us to reach the schools that are around us. And yes, we will, again, flood all the information to our school here, but we want other schools in the community to come and to be a part of our Vacation Bible School so that these kids hear about Jesus, right? And they come onto our campus and they have a great time and they eat snacks and they play games and it's awesome. But Vacation Bible School is a huge, huge deal because we can have over 100, 150 kids possibly come into our campus for just a few days and have 10 to 20 different decisions made for eternity in that 4 or 5 days, right? I know a lot of people that grew up in church that's when they decided to give their life to Christ. That's when I decided, when I was 7 or 8 years old, talking to my dad about VBS, and he was like, well, son, I won't get into all that. That's a long story. But that's whenever I gave my life to Christ, after a Vacation Bible School, right? VBS is a huge, huge outreach opportunity. It's not just something for us to do, but it takes all of us together. It's a huge event. So be ready for Pastor Zach and Miss Tiffany, our children's pastor, to come up and be like, hey, you're going to do this. And you better say, all right, I got you. Or you say, maybe I'm not really great at that. I can help you in a different way, because it's going to take all of us. And then another one that we have that's going to be coming up, which we're really excited about, is called Playmakers. And so Playmakers, it is led by Coach Roz, is what he goes by, Coach Roz, all right? And I'll be the point of contact for us here. But Coach Roz played in collegiate football, played in the NFL for a little bit, and he has this passion and this this community that's going out, and they're developing relationships with children that have developmental difficulties, all right, children with special needs, and giving them an opportunity to play football and play other sports as well. And it's just a great way. They're actually located out in California, but they're going to try and work this way. And just through a weird connection, or not a weird connection, but through a connection with Pastor Frank, I heard about us and said, hey, was that something your church would be interested in? It was like, I think we're pretty good at football, so maybe we could do it, work it out a little bit. But it just is really a part of our DNA from the church and the school side. But we're excited to have them coming. He'll actually be here the beginning of March sometime to give us some more information about that. But it's just a great way to build relationships with kids who don't get to be a part of sports, all right? And they don't get to be a part of things, and they'll learn how to play the game. But it's also just a great time for our kids, high schoolers, our youth, our students to come together, and they're the ones who are leading and guiding those kids and just providing so much joy and such a great relationship with those children that will come to that. So those are outreach opportunities that we have that are set up right now, right, that we have that you can get involved in immediately, right? Now, you're sitting here and thinking, well, Pastor Jake, those all sound great. Yeah, I'll help out with VBS because I know everyone has to. It's a part of our contract we signed as a member here. But all the other ones, I don't know if I'm really the person that really fits that very well. Well, here's the thing, right? Here's the thing about God's puzzle in our church, okay? Those are parts of our puzzle, that the pictures that come together, but it's not completely done, okay? Say you're really passionate about something that's not up there, right? Maybe it's, we used to have someone that ran our grief share, and we used to have people who did a lot with foster care and with special needs. Maybe it's, you know, someone with the Florida Baptist Children's Home and One More Child. It could be anything. If you have a connection and are passionate about something, we don't want to hinder you from wanting to do that, but we want to come alongside you and be able to tell our church, tell everyone, right, that, hey, this is something that we're behind and we love, and this person's excited about it, and we want to support you in prayer and through any way possible. Come and talk to me, right? That's a part of my job. That's what I'm supposed to do, is come. You come to me, talk to me about it, and we'll look at how we can best go about serving those people in that way in the community. These are just multiple ways that we have to serve, again, but you, if you have something that you're passionate about, please come and talk to me about it. Now, this is my challenge to you all, okay? Don't be a puzzled piece, okay? Don't be a puzzle piece, right? Some of you are pieces that are in the wrong spot of the puzzle right now. You think, I'm just going to do this because it's super easy. But God didn't want you to do something like that. He wants you to do something that's even maybe a little bit harder and stretches you out a little bit. But you're just content with being over here in this area and saying, you know what, I think I'm going to try and fit in right here. Now, there's definitely times in the puzzle where you fit in a piece and you're like, that's going to go there, right? But it doesn't. It messes up the whole thing. You mess up the puzzle when you do that. Some of you are pieces that are trying to be an inside piece, right, when you really should be an edge piece, right? Now, the edge pieces are important, right? You get the edges, all the edges, then you're able to see everything inside, right? Some of you, again, are thinking, you know what, I'm just going to be some piece in the middle here or part of this picture. But really, God's calling you to be someone who leads a ministry or leads an outreach opportunity and wants you to be an edge. Calling you to do something a little bit more. Some of you might even be a corner piece, right? Four corners. Those are important pieces. You find a corner, you're like, yes, I found a corner piece, right? We're getting closer, right? Some of you are called to maybe take on a little bit more. But you're content with saying, no, God, no, I don't trust that you designed me this way and gave me this passion. That's what you're saying to God. You're saying, I don't know if I trust in the way that you made me. And God doesn't make mistakes. He doesn't make anything that's bad. He makes things that are beautiful and going to do amazing things. But we have to be the people that see it and realize it. Then some of us are pieces that are on the outskirts, waiting, trying to see if the puzzle will finish without us, right? We're the pieces that are all around the edge, right? Sometimes I have to pull out the coffee table a little bit to put those pieces over there because my card table puzzle doesn't hold it all. So some of us are out here on the edge, and we're just sitting there going, you know what? Maybe that piece will fit in over there. You know what? Maybe this puzzle will come together, and I don't have to really do a whole lot. I can be on the outskirts, right? I don't have to get involved. Don't have to put any time into it. Don't have to put a lot of effort into it. And really, maybe that's not even what your mindset is, but sometimes you just sit back and you're not doing anything, and you're really just sitting on the sideline, and you're not being a part of God's solution. You're not being a part of his beautiful picture that he's painting for us. And with those pieces, right, then you're causing some other pieces to try and fill in the gaps in other spots, and causing that piece to be in not just the one spot they're supposed to be in, but in two or three spots, and they're being stretched out, and they're being burnt out because they're doing two, three, four things trying to serve in the church in this spot, trying to go and do outreach here, trying to go do outreach here, and then also trying to be serving their family as God has called them to, right? Especially us men, as the leaders of the house, we're supposed to be leading our families. But we're the people on the outskirts are causing the people inside to stretch and be torn apart to where that piece is not even, at some point, that piece is no longer being able to be used because you just get worn down. And then they say, you know what, I have to take a break and I have to go on the outskirts. And I have to find myself again and find the way that God created me to be. We don't need to be pieces that are on outskirts. We need to be pieces that are finding our spot, finding out where we are to go, right? There it is. I thought I lost a piece of paper. I was like, well, the ending's up in there for you guys. I found it. It's okay. But we need to be people who are finding out how God has made us, right? How he's made us. If you haven't done an inventory of yourself, right, you and God, made a mission statement for yourself, I encourage you to do that somehow, right? I was able to in college. We were able to go away on a trip and figure out a mission statement, figure out kind of what, how God's designed us to be. And so mine was very pretty simple, I thought, compared to a lot of other people's that took, like, way more time looking at a lot of things. And I was like, I think this is it. But mine was just simple as I'm created to develop and to serve others. And then at that time, it was specifically children, to experience and understand God's love and to find their passions so that they can fully live in him, to fully live in God. That was my life purpose statement that I made, right? I knew I was someone who likes helping and getting people to a good spot. I like serving others, especially when it's kids or teenagers, and getting them to understand who they are, but for them to not only experience God, but to understand his love, and that they are made specifically to pursue him in a specific, unique way, right? We're all created to do that. So be the piece of the puzzle that God intends you to be, right? You may be a corner piece, you may be an edge piece, you may be an inside piece. You may be a really big piece, you may be a really small piece, but every single piece to God's puzzle is exactly the way that he wants it to be, right? It's exactly what he wants. And if we all come together and are acting out of our piece, right, being who we're supposed to be, then we will be able to see, as a church, God's beautiful puzzle, not just right here on this campus, right, because as a church, we're not called to sit here and just come together, but to go out and to reach other people. And they'll see, and they'll come a part of our puzzle. They'll come a part of our beautiful picture that God's creating. But we have to know who we are in Christ first, and we have to know who we're supposed to be. So use your passions and gifts. You use them in every day. You know that? Like, you use them in the way, the things that you like to do, and the way that you talk, and the relationships that you have. Even at work, you use them. Hopefully, you use them at work. Like, you actually enjoy your work. And you use them whenever you're with your family. So why would you not use them in church in the way that God created you, right? It just doesn't make sense to not do that. So I'm going to challenge you guys to figure out what piece you guys are of the puzzle and to get off of the side of the table and be a part of God's beautiful picture. You guys, bow your heads as I pray this morning. Dear God, we thank you so much just for, God, you giving us your word that we can come to and we can look at and we can see your plan that you have for us, God. God, we know that you created us to do an amazing and awesome things, God, but we have to come to you to figure out how you made us and why you made us. And God, ultimately, we know that we are made to serve others and to tell them about you. God, I pray that each and every one of us in here can know what piece we are and how we fit. And God, that you can just continue to lead us and to grow us as we reach our community and those that you put around us, God. God, we're so thankful that we're in a spot where our church is striving to reach those around us. And not just sitting back and waiting for those to come, but God, that we're going out into the community. God, we pray that you can continue to build up leaders and build up opportunities that we can go and seek out more people, God. And we just pray ultimately that you have all the glory, you have all the praise, and that people come to know you. In Jesus' name, amen.